What are you doing? It's a Sasquatch chord, bro. Damn. In 1958, a small, seemingly insignificant article was published in the Humboldt Times by Andrew Gonzoli about loggers in Northern California who had discovered mysteriously large footprints. It was at that moment the Bigfoot myth was born. The rest is history. So why is Bigfoot still with us? Why does it hold so much appeal? Why do we want to believe Bigfoot is out there somewhere? Why? Bigfoot researchers say it's real, but so far, and after more than 60 years, no hard evidence has been found. And yes, you are in the right channel, and this is a video about music theory, specifically about chords. Or is it? This is a series where we investigate mysterious phenomena and search for the musical structures hidden in them using advanced music theory concepts, numerology, and whatever other weird thing we can think of. Welcome to CryptoChords. Cool. Let's start with the basics, shall we? Bigfoot is this elusive, massive mammal. It has been spotted thousands of times in the last 60 years, but we're still waiting to find one piece of hard evidence, such as a dead body or good footage. The closest we've got to it is in this famous picture and in this footprint. But while doing our research, we also found this recording with Bigfoot sounds. So we've transcribed his singing, and we found out, not surprisingly, that there's a B-flat in there, and a really out of tune, a really flat A-flat also. Of course the first note was gonna be a B-flat. Come on, B-flat, big, foot, it's all there in the name. So without a doubt, the original Bigfoot crypto chord has to be a B-flat chord. But what kind of chord? Is it a major triad with the root, the major third, and the fifth? Or is it a minor triad with the flat three? Well, obviously, the chord has to be a seventh chord. Remember, chords are built by stacking thirds. So when you put a chord together, you have the root, which is one, and then a third, and then a fifth. And if you stack one more third, you get a seventh chord. Why does it have to be a seventh chord, you ask? Well, just count the letters in Bigfoot. It's seven letters. We need more info to find out what type of chord Bigfoot is. But the next clue was nowhere to be found. The revelation occurred when we found out there's another name that this creature goes by, Sasquatch. And that was the answer. Bigfoot's chord had to be a B-flat 7 Sasquatch. However, this is not your ordinary B-flat 7 sus 4, which is a dominant chord with a suspended fourth. As you know, the B-flat 7 is 1, 3, 5, and flat 7. B-flat, D, F, and A-flat. While a B-flat 7 sus 4 is the same chord, but replacing the third with a fourth, we call this chord sus, as in suspended. The fourth is a suspension that wants to resolve to the third. So the D is replaced by an E-flat, and now we have this chord, B-flat 7, sus 4. Sure, our 7 Sasquatch chord had to be somehow related to a 7 sus 4, but how? What are the differences? We needed more clues. All right, I've got an idea. I've created an audio file of 8 hours of Bigfoot sounds that I'm gonna play while I'm sleeping. And this is either going to drive me more insane or help me solve the next piece of the puzzle.
Six hours later.
Okay, it's 3 a.m. and I think I've just had a revelation. There's a couple frequencies out of place with Bigfoot's cry, and I need to check on this like right away. I'm pretty sure the answer lies somewhere here. All right, so I've loaded the original Bigfoot sound file into Adobe Audition because I need to check something out. So let's listen to the file. There's so much noise. Let's clean it up. I'll capture the noise prints and then run the noise reduction plugin in Audition. This plugin is awesome to remove noise. That's a lot better. So now let's look at the frequencies present in Bigfoot's notes. Well, that's kind of crazy. Look at this. There are three main frequencies in these notes. Let's zoom in and see what's going on here. So before we go any further here, perhaps it might be helpful if we take a step back, go over to the piano, and show you what's going on here. So whenever you play or sing a note, you're also playing a series of notes known as the overtone series. Unless you're playing a pure sine wave, which only contains the main frequency, every note played in an acoustic instrument is accompanied by all of the notes in the overtone series. So when you play a B flat, you're also playing the next note in the series, which is a B flat, just an octave higher. And then an F, which is a perfect fifth above the last note, and so on. Each one of these notes has a different amplitude or volume, and it usually fades away as we go on to the next in the harmonic series. The combination of all these notes with their respective amplitudes is what gives the instrument its timbre. So a piano has a very different amplitude distribution in the overtone series than, let's say, a flute. So let me show you what I mean. When I play this B flat on the piano, I'm also accessing or playing this B flat here and also this F here, along with a whole other series of overtones. And I can prove this to you very simply by doing this. If I hold down that first overtone note relative to the lower B flat, I can get this damper to stay off of the strings, which will allow the strings to vibrate sympathetically to the overtone series that relates to this B flat. So that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna hold down this B flat, let those dampers free up those strings to vibrate, hit this B flat, and you're going to hear this note resonate. So there it is. There's our first note in the overtone series related to that B flat. Let's do the same thing with the next note in the overtone series, B flat's overtone series, this F. So I'm gonna free up the dampers on the F strings and do the same thing and see if we can access, by way of sympathetic vibration, this B flat's second overtone. Here we go. And there it is, right? So there we have, and we can keep going with this, explore all of the notes in the overtone series. And just to show you that we're not just getting vibrations in the piano to get these strings to speak or sing, I'll use a note that's not very strong in B-flat's overtone series, something that doesn't vibrate very sympathetically, this E right here. So if I do the same exact process with this E and I try to get it to resonate sympathetically, it won't. Just silence. So now that you know this amazing fact, I'm gonna record this B flat here and then take it over to the computer on Audition. This should clear some things up. So here I have the B flat I just played on the piano and the frequencies present. Let me zoom in. Now, the brighter the color, the louder the frequency is in the recording. So we expect the main pitch, which was a B flat 2, to be the loudest, and there it is. Then an octave above, which is B flat 3, then the fifth above that note, which should be F 4. Then yet another octave above the original pitch, that should be B flat 4. Wow, look how loud it is compared to the second frequency in the overtone series. That's exactly what I was saying before about the timbre of the instrument. See, a piano has these specific amplitude values for each frequency in the overtone series. It's what gives it its piano-ness. And the next note is the major third, the D5. So in a way, every time you play a note, you're playing a major triad. Pretty wild. So now, let's apply this newfound understanding of overtones to that Bigfoot audio file. When we look at the frequencies in Bigfoot's note, there are clearly three main frequencies. So I'm expecting to find a B flat, then another B flat above that, and then an F above that, right? All right, let me zoom in. Well, would you look at that? A B flat, another B flat, and an E? That must have been what was out of place earlier when I was listening to those recordings. I knew there was something to be found there, and it looks like we found it. So we discovered that the E natural was very prominent, which is very odd also. As I just showed you, the B flat should make the F ring, not the E. And by the way, the A flat note that the Bigfoot sings contains a very strong E flat, as predicted. With this amazing insight, we were able to find two more notes in our Sasquatch chord. So far, we have this: B flat, E flat, E, and A flat. We're getting closer to our Sasquatch chord. This chord is very interesting because it is a B flat 7 sus 4 with a flat 5. A B flat 7 sus 4 is B flat, E flat, F, and A flat, right? But our chord, so far, is the same chord with an E natural, which is an F flat instead of the F. So our Sasquatch chord is so far the same as a B flat 7 sus 4 flat 5. So far, so good. But this tiny chord cannot possibly be Bigfoot's chord. There has to be much more to it. If you follow us at all, you know how much we use upper structures to create interesting colors in music. And this is what we need to complete our chord, upper structures. But where to look for them? That's the question. I need to access my inner spiritual musician. Okay. Bigfoot. Oh, I'm sorry. This is probably backwards for you. Let me think in reverse. So, Bigfoot. This is clearly showing that our B flat chord has a G chord with an F on top of it. But what is oot? Does it mean oot, which sounds like the German oot, which means do, representing that the do or the root of the chord is in the name? Or does it mean that the F is diminished? But what is the other O-T? Maybe it means watch out for the tritone, as in don't forget the tritone. Of course, it means all of the above. So we can finally finish building our Sasquatch chord. At last, I had found out how to build a 7 Sasquatch chord. If B flat is the root, then B flat, E flat, E, and A flat is our lower structure. And the upper structure is a G triad with an F diminished. We now have the G major triad, the F diminished here, and the A flat with the D to make sure the tritone is there. The 7 Sasquatch has been found, and it sounds like this. Awesome. So how do you play a B flat 7 Sasquatch chord? Well, on the piano, I can show you the full chord with all 9 notes. On the left hand, we need to do this: B flat, the root of the chord, and then we're gonna play the fourth, E flat, followed by the flat fifth, F flat, or E, and then we have our seventh. So in our left hand, we basically have a B flat 7 sus with a flat 5. On the right hand, we're gonna get the rest of our chord by just basically playing a G7 and first inversion with the seventh of the chord, A flat, on top. So we'll get this, B, D, F, and G. There's our G7 in first inversion. And then I'm just gonna add the seventh of the chord, A flat, on top. So there's all nine notes broken apart, and this is what our chord is gonna sound like once we put all nine of those notes together. So to play this chord on the guitar, we have to compromise a little bit as we only have six strings and yet nine notes, but I'm gonna show you something today that's gonna help you play the B-flat 7sus chord, at least the essence of it, on the guitar. So we're gonna start by just completely barring the sixth fret and then work our way from there. So on the sixth string, the E string, we have our B-flat, our sixth fret note, and then we're gonna go to the A string on the seventh fret, back to the sixth fret on the D string, and then over to the A fret on the G string. Same thing for the B string. We're gonna hit that eighth fret again, and then we're just gonna hit up the sixth fret on our first string. So this is gonna give us the root, the flat five, the seventh, and then we have our fourth over here, our sus note, our 13 there on the B string, and then the root again up there on the E string. B-flat 7, Sasquatch. So where can you use this chord? Well, this is an amazing chord to end a blues with. But let's take it a bit further and honor that 1958 article that started the whole thing. How do we do that? Obvious, isn't it? The article was published in 1958. The digits are 1, 9, 5, and 8, which is an upper structure chordal starting on the second degree, right? In B flat, that's B flat on the bass, and then the ninth, C, the fifth, F, and the eighth, which is B flat again. So now, when you use the 7susQuatch in your band, you can finish the blues like this. Cool sound, right? Not sure? Just listen to the mix where we added Bigfoot's recording to our ending and wait to be blown away. All right, thanks for watching. If you're still here, you must be as crazy as we are. But I hope you learned something from this video. And the best part is, now you know how to play a 7susQuatch chord. And if you really want a conversation starter, and to impress your friends with your music knowledge, or give the perfect gift to your musician friend, you need this crypto shirt, which I'm wearing to present this video, but will also mysteriously take us to this video. What are you doing? It's a Sasquatch chord, bro. Damn. I think I hear something. What are you doing? I'm playing the Sasquatch chord, man. You're an idiot.